Public Audit Committee in 2016. Can I first of all ask all those present to ensure that the electronic items are switched to flight mode so that they don't affect the work of the committee. Colleagues, can we move to agenda item number one, which is a decision in taking business in private. The question is that we take agenda item number seven in private. Are we all agreed? Now move to agenda item number two, which is evidence on the joint AGS report and the Accounts Commission report entitled The Community Planning An Update. I'd like to welcome our panel of witnesses. We have Caroline Gardner, the Auditor General for Scotland, Douglas Sinclair, the Chair of the Accounts Committee, and Antony Clark, the Assistant Director of Audit Scotland. I understand that the Auditor General would like to make a short opening statement.
Thank you, Convener. Good morning. You may remember that the Chair of the Accounts Commission and I gave evidence to this committee in December last year on our report, Improving Community Planning, Turning Ambition into Action. Today's report provides an update on progress since then and gives a sense of the direction of travel for community planning in the context of the Statement of Ambition. As you'll see in part one of the report, there have been significant changes to the policy landscape since our last report. These include the Community Empowerment Bill becoming an act, the integration of health and social care, and the introduction of the Community Justice Scotland Bill. These all have important implications for community planning, which we cover in the report. Overall, we found that progress on community planning is being made both locally and nationally, but it's still not delivering the ambitious changes in the way public services are delivered that were set out in the Statement of Ambition. We make a number of recommendations in the report for the Scottish Government, COSLA, and community planning partnerships themselves. Community planning partnerships are building on the positive progress we reported in 2014. In particular, they're using data to set clearer priorities, and they are continuing to implement a range of projects targeted at specific groups or communities. But we have yet to see community planning partners sharing their resources in significantly different ways and on a large enough scale to deliver their priorities. We found that there's also a need to streamline national performance management frameworks to allow community planning partnerships to more clearly focus on outcome improvements that are relevant to their communities, again, as set out in the Statement of Ambition. Critically, this should mean placing the views of local communities at the heart of measuring success in public services. We'd like to see greater leadership at a national level by the Scottish Government and COSLA through a strong, authoritative national forum that can address the barriers to effective community planning and ensure that partnerships get the support they need to flourish. We'd also like to see leadership at the local level driving forward public service reform. Partnerships should ensure that local communities are given a strong voice in planning, delivering and assessing their own public services. Finally, the report recommends that the Scottish Government and COSLA must set out a clear route map for improving community planning, with short, medium and long-term steps to be taken both nationally and locally. They should work with the Improvement Service and others to establish a locally tailored programme of improvement support. Convener, as always, my colleagues and I are happy to answer the committee's questions.
Can I thank the Auditor General? Can I just draw your attention to Appendix 1 of the report? And he advises that the National Community Planning Group hasn't met or hadn't met since December 2014. I understand that the response you've received from the Scottish Government, but did that concern you in terms of here is a significant part of the context of the strategy it should be taken forward and the group can't even meet on a regular basis?
Yeah, it is a matter of concern, Convener. As we say in Key Message 5 in the report, we do think that stronger national leadership is needed. Community planning is intended to be right at the heart of public service reform to manage both the financial pressures that public services face and the move towards prevention that's a core part of the Scottish Government's policy. And we do think there's a real need for that strong national forum that can provide leadership and that can tackle some of the problems that get in the way of that happening. The Scottish Government says that it's reviewing how to provide that leadership in future, but the fact that it has only met once since our last report is a matter of concern.
Was there any specific explanation as to why the meeting wasn't reconvened after December 2014?
I think that's a better question for the government, but our understanding is that they are reviewing the way in which that leadership is provided across the piece.
Yeah, but obviously if they can't arrange regular meetings as such as that to ensure that strategy is taken forward and no one's organising that, then it does create a picture of pretty much in terms of monitoring and having proper records kept of the meetings and ensuring that action points are taken forward if there can't be regular meetings take place, then how can the organisation be taken forward?
I can only agree that strong national leadership is needed given the scale of the reform that's required here. I think it wasn't just a matter of drift. The government has told us that it is reviewing whether to stand that group down and put in its place some other forum. That forum isn't yet in place, and we think that's slowing down the pace of change.
And just to clarify for the record, so which specific department would be responsible for that within the government?
There isn't a department in quite that way due to the way in which the Scottish Government structures itself. The accountable officer will be the Director General for Communities. Yeah.
So Director General of Communities?
Yes.
Should have ensured that such meetings are progressed and actioned. And this is where you would expect the leadership to derive. So this is, it would be at this point that you would expect leadership to be taken forward.
That's where the responsibility for leadership sits.
So the fact that they can't hold the meeting is something that you've audited, and obviously you're concerned that has there been one recently, or has there just not been one?
There was one, as we say in the report, immediately after our report in 2014 was published. Since then, the government has been looking at how to take forward the other recommendations and the requirements of things like the Community Empowerment Act and the new Community Justice Bill. And the audit engagement we've had, they've told us that they're planning how best to take that forward in future. That said, there has been no meeting since that initial one after our November 2014 report.
Can I just say finally on that then, it just seems to be another example of highly paid public officials who have a significant responsibility to carry out the basics. And this would be, ensuring that there's a plan of meetings, a timetable of meetings to take forward and show leadership hasn't actually happened. If they can't get that basic right, then it does question some of the other basics that have to be taken forward, given some of the challenges that you've set out in the community planning document.
I think all I can do is restate what's in the report, convener, that for reform on this scale, strong national leadership is needed, and we haven't seen enough of that in the period since the last report.
Ms Scanlon.
Thank you, convener. Can I just say that we seem to have been talking about community planning since 1999, and I think all parties were signed up to it, and having read the Christie Commission at the time, which colleagues will remember, it was actually seen to be the answer to the future delivery of public services, which were seen to be unsustainable, working in silos. If I can just sort of go over history a wee bit, I've got three reports in front of me today, and I know you've done more than that, but this one is March 2013. And if I may, convener, just say, a quote from the report, 10 years after community planning was given a statutory basis, CPPs are not able to show they've had a significant impact on delivering improved outcomes, not clear about their priorities. Too often, everything seemed to be a priority and nothing is a priority, and there's no consequences for not participating. That's report number one. So you would think after that fairly hard-hitting report that the next report might be better. So that's November 2014. And there is little evidence that CPP boards are yet demonstrating the levels of leadership and challenge set out in the Statement of Ambition. Many still do not set out the improvements that CPPs are aiming to achieve, the lack of focus on how community planning will improve outcomes for specific communities, and so importantly, especially for this government, and reduce the gaps in outcomes between the most and the least deprived. That is my huge concern, that they are not in any shape or form tackling inequalities across Scotland. So I come on to the final one, if I may, convener, so that takes us up to March 2016. And of course, I would like being an optimistic person thinking they've seen all the problems, they've addressed it. Seems to me we're no further forward. March 2016, not yet delivering the ambitious change in which public services are organised that were envisaged in the Statement of Ambition. We have yet to see CPP partners sharing, aligning or deploying their resources. And again, stronger leadership required. And paragraph 44, the failure of the Scottish Government and COSLA to clarify performances of CPPs is a significant issue. So what we're looking at 13 years after community planning partnerships, and I have to say, Auditor General, if I may, the huge amount of work that Audit Scotland has done on this issue, the fact that Community Planning Partnership has the support of 129 MSPs. This is a significant failure and it's laid at the door of the Scottish Government for lack of leadership. Am I right?
I understand your frustration, Ms Scanlon. Paragraph 4 of our report sets out the previous work we've done in this area, and there's been a lot over the last few years. There have been efforts to move community planning forward, and as we've reported, as you've highlighted, that hasn't resulted in the pace or scale of change that's needed, particularly given the position that is put forward for community planning by the government at the heart of its reform agenda. We will, I think, be reviewing our own plans for further audit work in this area, given the sense that it simply isn't having the desired effect. The Chair of the Commission may want to say something more about that to reflect the fact that the Cabinet Secretary asked the Commission to take on responsibility for auditing this important policy area back in 2012 on the back of the Statement of Ambition.
Thank you.
Excuse me.
I can well understand your frustration.
You've been here before as well. You've heard it all before.
Indeed. Yeah. I think it's not quite right to lay all the blame at the door of the Scottish Government.
I quoted from the report.
Yeah, but there's equally an issue for COSLA as well.
Yes.
The national leadership is a shared one.
Of course.
Given the commitment both parties had to making sure that community planning was a success. I think one of the difficulties has always been the statement of ambition, because in many ways it was overambitious. It suggested, for example, that community planning partnerships should have all the characteristics of boards, and they're voluntary partnerships, they're not statutory bodies. There was also a kind of sense that everything, including the kitchen sink, was the responsibility of community planning partnerships, rather than being more precise about the areas where they could make a difference, where there are cross-cutting budgets between, for example, health and local government. So I think there's been a process of refinement and trying to focus on where community planning can make a difference. It has taken longer than one would like to think, but we do identify in the report that there is paragraph two, that there is progress. They are improving leadership and scrutiny, but at the same time we're saying there's still a strong need for national leadership to ensure that local delivery is as effective as possible. Maybe just return to your point, convener, with the National Community Planning Group. I think the existence of a group of national leadership is important because it signifies a statement of commitment by government. The very existence of having a group of that kind representing all the key stakeholders demonstrates and underlines the commitment by the government. The absence of a group runs the danger of sending a very contrary message.
Thank you. I think when you talk about everything but the kitchen sink, I can't quite find it, but I did note that the list of participants in community planning had actually been extended. I'm sorry, I can't find the actual page that it's on.
Yeah.
So if you're complaining about everybody but the kitchen sink, got more now.
No, I think it's good that all the partners around the table, who should be around the table, one of the problems in the past has been a very variability of representation on the community planning partnerships. So there's no excuse for all the partners are statutorily required to be there. My point was that I think community planning partnerships if there was a fault, they tried to be overambitious in what they could do. And I think there's been a process whereby they've focused on the areas where partners have a common interest, for example, drugs, alcohol, areas like that, where they can add value because they have overlapping budgets.
Okay, can I just ask another question? We've actually heard the same issues. I was on the first health committee along with Richard Simpson in 1999, and when we were doing the free personal care, community care bill, we were constantly being told that health and social work didn't really talk to each other. So 17 years later, we had to bring in legislation to make them work together. I mean, that's pretty serious in a country of 5 million people. Do we need to legislate to make community partners work? And then I have one other question after that. Do you think it requires legislation given the lack of progress?
I think one of the concerns that the Commissioner and I share is that we now have two sets of legislation about community planning. We have the Community Planning Act from 2003, and we now have the new Community Empowerment Bill, which shares the responsibility for leading it and, as you've said, increases the number of partners who are statutory partners. My view is that legislation can take you so far, but it's really not going to make the difference in terms of people's genuine willingness and ability to have a shared vision for their area, to bring together their resources, not just money, but people and communities and everything else to focus on where they get to. The legislation, I think, isn't the problem. It is how you use that and how you align your performance management frameworks, your accountability arrangements, your incentives to make it happen in practice.
And yes.
Could I just add to that? I think it's interesting that no community planning partnership has used the legislation to become an incorporated body, to become a statutory body. That's my first point. A second point is to raise the question, in the complexity of the public service landscape in Scotland, would there be enough space for two statutory partnerships, a health and social care partnership and a community planning partnership? I think that is a real issue.
No, I thought that was a question worth asking. If I may just finish on some smaller points that I picked up. Paragraph 37, you do use the example of Moray, which is quite a nice coterminous council area, etc. Are you using that example because it is the exception to the rule? Is there best practice in Moray that we could perhaps learn from? And if I may, convener, just throw in my other questions. Paragraph 58, I didn't quite understand what was meant by the 14-day delayed discharge target is an example of a performance measure creating unintended consequences that run counter to the government's commitment to be preventive. I didn't quite understand that, and I wonder if I could ask for clarity from Caroline or Antony. And my final question, convener, is paragraph 61. We found the Scottish Government's commitment to maintain police officer numbers and no compulsory redundancies for police staff was limiting the SPA and Police Scotland's flexibility to deliver savings. It's just left there, and I would very much appreciate some clarity on those points.
I'll pick up the latter two, if I may, and then ask Antony to pick up Moray. I think that's the best approach. On delayed discharges, we make the point that we've made in previous reports on the NHS and health and social care, that there are good reasons for, first of all, measuring how long critical parts of people's journey through health and social care matter, and in some instances, as you've heard from the accountable officer, having targets to tackle bottlenecks and particular problems. But the reason for including delayed discharges there is the concern that we have reported before, that the target came down from 28 days to 14 days without a proper understanding of whether the resources were in place consistently across Scotland to make that a reality, to make sure that the whole system was working in balance rather than focusing on one number in isolation. I think in our overview report on the NHS last year, we highlighted the fact that we've got a whole range of targets at different points in people's journey, A&E, elective treatment, through to delayed discharge, and it's not clear that the whole system is in balance to make sure that works properly.
So, convener, what were the unintended consequences, and how does that work counter to preventative care?
The unintended consequences are that if people are managing particular points of a system rather than the system as a whole, you may end up getting decisions that are made that help you hit 14 days for a delayed discharge target, but make it more likely perhaps that people are discharged slightly before they're ready or without the ideal package of care being in place that increases the chance of them being readmitted later.
Okay.
So that's what we're looking at. And the wider concern in this report is the one that people who are running individual public bodies like health boards or councils are being held to account much more rigorously for the targets that affect their body, like delayed discharges for an NHS chief exec, than they are for the overall working of the health and social care system in their
area. So really the targets come before the patients?
The targets come before the working of the system as a whole, and that's the risk.
Before the patient's well-being, if they're being discharged inappropriately when perhaps the whole care package isn't in place, but the NHS has met a target.
patients are obviously best served by the system as a whole working.
Yes, I understand.
And that's what we're hoping to see.
Thank you. And
on the police reform.
Yeah.
Again, in my report on police reform back in November 2013, I highlighted that the government's target of maintaining police numbers at a minimum of 17,234 due to the commitment to an additional 1,000 officers was an entirely appropriate policy choice to make, but it did make it harder for the SPA and Police Scotland to manage the financial pressures that they're facing. We don't yet have a financial strategy for the SPA and Police Scotland, so we don't know how they're looking to reconcile that.
Still no financial strategy.
But it's a straightforward consequence of the choice which is there.
Yeah, thank you. And just
In terms of the question you asked about Murray on paragraph 38, that was an example that we found when we were doing our audit work of a partnership working together to develop an approach for community engagement. So rather than individual partners consulting and engaging with communities, doing it across the piece. It's one of the many examples that we found when we were doing our audit work of CPPs working well together to do things that make sense for their communities. And they fell into five different categories, really. We found lots of examples of people focusing on early years and prevention, lots of examples of people doing work on community safety and youth offending, and quite a few good examples of what you might call community-led projects, where the partners have identified assets, like an unused pub in their area, that the community is then taking over and using to run youth groups or evening classes and so on and so forth. So it's one of those examples of really good projects that are working well in communities.
That's good. Thank you for that.
Mr. Summers has promised me he's got 2:30 seconds.
One on the police issue. I mean, you said it was an appropriate policy. It's obviously up to government to decide what their policy is, but if the consequences of their policy in that respect of determining the numbers in any given area, if the consequence of that is increased inefficiency, and in fact, in the case of the police, dangers, because the call centre staff now have police in it who are not trained, and we've seen the effects in my constituency on the case on the M90, but others as well. Are you able to comment on the effects and make comparisons to other jurisdictions where the crime rate has gone down just as much in England as it has in Scotland, but the police numbers have gone down substantially in England, so it hasn't had the negative effect on the crime rates, and yet the cost in Scotland is huge?
At this stage, I'm not able to comment on that. I'm specifically precluded from commenting on the merits of policy, and it's a government policy choice to make. That's absolutely an appropriate thing for government to do. As I said in my 2013 report, a consequence of that is that there is less flexibility in ways of making the financial savings that are required. And I do have the powers to come along once we've seen the changes that are being made, once the financial strategy is in place, to assess the value for money that achieves.
And compare it with other jurisdictions?
I'm not in a position to do that at the moment, though.
You don't have the power to do that?
No, I can make comparisons to help me with my assessment of value for money.
Value for money,
absolutely,
yeah, yes.
But I'm not in a position to do it at the moment.
No, I understand. Sorry, thank you.
Combity.
Thank you, Vienna. Well, General, I welcome the positive aspects of this report. It's good to see that there's some progress coming through there. You have, however, said that progress is incremental rather than the radical results that everybody's looking for. And worryingly, you've looked at seven other countries which have had exactly that experience, that the improvements have been incremental rather than radical. What are we learning from that? Do you think that's a sort of an ominous portent of what's going to come?
I think, as we say in the report, and you quite rightly identify, there is experience of other governments trying to tackle similar problems in similar ways, and their experience has been similar in that the change they've achieved has been incremental rather than transformational. I think that tells us that this is very hard, that there are no easy answers, and certainly we've not come across one that we think the government should be doing. But given the central place that community planning has in the government's policy agenda around both meeting the financial challenges that lie ahead and moving upstream to prevention rather than dealing with the effects of problems, we need to up the pace and scale of change. We think there is room to do that further by, for example, putting in place the national coordinating mechanism that's needed to coordinate policy, deal with problems and monitor progress, by doing some of the things we've suggested around performance frameworks and the targets and outcomes that people are held to account for. And we're very clear that there's no magic wand that would suddenly make this have all of the desired impact that has been around for a while.
Now, I don't know how deeply you looked at the seven countries involved, but is there anything we can learn from that? Are some doing better than others? Is there examples of good practice that could perhaps be transported over here?
I'll ask Antony to talk you through that.
As Caroline says, we didn't find an example of a silver bullet that can make everything perfect around partnership working and community planning. What we did find was that in these other countries, the challenges that Scotland faces in terms of the complexities of governance and the resourcing pressures have been hindrances in those countries as they have been in Scotland. What I would say is that, having looked across the piece, we didn't find another country that set such high expectations of community planning, which I think is an important point to put on the record.
Okay. One thing I'd like to pick up on is several times in the report there's talk of question of leadership and national leadership, and particularly around the NCPG, which hasn't met since 2014. And I'm very curious about that, because obviously there's a concern if there isn't national leadership. But on the other hand, in paragraph 48, you've said lack of leadership doesn't appear to have hindered progress in CPP. So I'm just wondering how that ties up.
One of the reasons both Douglas and I are here is because we think that national leadership needs to come both from the Scottish Government and from COSLA and local government, and Douglas may want to comment in a moment. We go on in paragraph 48 to say that although there is local progress being made, it is incremental and small scale, and that's not enough to tackle either the scale of the challenges that communities across Scotland are facing for a whole range of reasons and achieve their potential, or to fulfil the very central role in policy that the Scottish Government has given it since the 2012 Statement of Ambition. So yes, progress is being made, but we think that stronger national leadership could help that progress to be both faster and wider reaching.
Yeah, can I just give a further example of that? That one of the recommendations about the importance of a well-coordinated national programme of support that reflects good practice and is tailored to meet the needs of individual CPPs, that's an identical replica of the recommendation we made in our last report. And whilst we recognise there's a lot of work going on by the Improvement Service and by other bodies, What Works Scotland, the absence of the overall coordination of these initiatives by caused on the Scottish Government remains an outstanding issue. And we do make the point in our report that CPPs are making progress at different rates. If we can close that gap, that's in everyone's interest.
Just building on that point about progressing at different rates, I was looking at paragraph 44, where it says the statement of ambition is being interpreted in different ways and there are different views about what community planning is for. That seems pretty fundamental. Is there really a huge divergence in approaches here?
Well, I come back to the point I made earlier, that, and we've made this point in previous reports, that if anything, the statement of ambition was overambitious. It makes reference, as I said, to community planning partnerships, voluntary bodies acting with all the authority and attributes of a board. And to be fair to the NCPG, one of the last things they did was to refocus down the priorities that they saw for a community planning partnerships, a focus on outcomes, a focus on reducing inequalities and better community engagement. I think slimming down the expectations to a more realistic level has been and will continue to be important.
And there's a real opportunity to do that through the statutory guidance that's planned to accompany the Community Empowerment Act. We haven't yet seen that in detail. As we say throughout the report, that guidance is a real opportunity to tackle some of the things that we think are slowing down progress or stopping it from being as fast as it could be. Getting that guidance right and making sure that it really takes the intentions of the bill and makes them real will be a key step forward.
To what extent is a reluctance at local level to pool resources and pool, for want of a better word, responsibility, holding things up? Is that a key issue?
I think there are probably a couple of issues, and Douglas will want to come in on this. In order for community planning partnerships to really fulfil the ambition that's set out for them, they will need to pull not just budgets, but people and planning and all of the things they do around their key priorities, the communities that are most disadvantaged and the outcomes they most want to shift. That's difficult to do in any case for a whole range of reasons, but particularly difficult at a time when budgets are being cut for reasons that we all understand. So thinking through what that means for actually being able to get that really joined up working, which should be at the heart of community planning partnerships, and taking away as many of the barriers as possible feels to us key. That's why this focus on different performance targets or performance indicators in different bodies doesn't help, because people are being pulled in two directions. They're thinking about the partnership, but they're also thinking about what, for example, waiting times for elective treatment look like, rather than being able to say what are the most important things for this area.
Did you find any good examples where there are positive aspects in a CPP, where they've actually been successful in some regard of pulling the resources and so forth?
Antony, I'm sure, has got a couple of examples that we can point you towards on that.
Glasgow was an obvious example for us, where the Glasgow City Council and police and other partners, including the Housing Association, have made great strides in terms of targeting resources into disadvantaged communities. They've also made great progress in terms of using fire and rescue in quite innovative ways to support people in residential care homes and in other social housing facilities. North Ayrshire, great examples there of police working very collaboratively with the council to address youth offending, and do work in communities to address fear of crime and tidy up the local environment. And in Scottish Borders, some very interesting projects where, across the partnership, they've been looking at unused assets and trying to work with communities to make better use of buildings that are currently dilapidated, that might have a community use. There are quite a few more I could list for you, but we found many examples in all eight of the CPPs that we've done work at.
So do these constitute the incremental improvements that you were talking about?
Absolutely. They're all good projects in their own right, but they're not, as Caroline said earlier and Douglas, whole-scale systems change. They're things that make a real difference to communities, but they aren't necessarily affecting the whole of the way in which public resources are used across the whole system.
Just had a comment there about perhaps capacity. Caroline's touched on the difficult financial environment in which public bodies are operating. And I think there is an issue about capacity to support community planning partnerships. One of the positive things about the Community Empowerment Act is that it shifts the leadership from simply the council to all the partners as a collective leadership. And it does require all the partners to have a duty to commit staff, resources, etc., to support the partnership. That's all well and good, but the Act is light on what happens if they don't do that. That's point number one. Secondly, I think there is an issue of a lot of the people who will be involved in councils and health boards and others, councils and health boards in particular, supporting community planning partnerships, will be the same people who are supporting the introduction and development of the integrated joint boards. There's an issue in there about the scale and depth of capacity to manage and support both partnerships.
And just finally, has the Scottish Government accepted your recommendations on this?
I think that would be a useful thing for the committee to confirm, having considered the report today.
Page 7 of the report, community planning partnerships should ensure local communities have a strong voice in planning, delivering and assessing local public services. How engaged are local communities? Is their voice really listened to and their views? Because my experience, not only as a local councillor, but it's the last 5 years as an MSP, is a lot of time their views are not listened to. It's lip service has been given to them.
It's a really good question. I think we say in the report that there are lots of examples of communities being consulted on specific issues or projects or policies, but not yet signs that the whole way in which public services are planned and managed and assessed being turned on its head to start with what people want. I guess both Douglas and Antony may want to colour that in a little bit more.
I think I'd echo Caroline's comments about the state as we see it at the moment. But what we would observe is, I think, a real commitment amongst the CPPs to try and do this. Our sense is that the community empowerment legislation has been welcomed by many CPPs. They recognise the value of trying to design services that are more community-focused, but also recognise that there are difficulties there in terms of Douglas's point around capacity. Do we have the staff with the skills and the time to do this kind of stuff? And also the rigidities in terms of how can we change our services? You know, the services have been provided in a particular way for good reason. Changing them isn't always an easy thing to do. So this is quite difficult stuff for the CPPs to do, but we do get a sense that there's an appetite to try and move that agenda forward.
Simpson? Yes. I want to ask a couple of questions. The first one is about looking at areas where things have not worked. So, for example, Stirling and Clackmannanshire endeavoured to start sharing significant services. I mean, they were doing what Christie really wanted them to do until this budget, when the Stirling officials reported to their councillors that they were subsidising the neighbouring council to the extent of £400,000 a year, and the services have now been split. I mean, that seems to me to be, in terms of where we're trying to get to, that's a very clear backward step, but an understandable one if you're a politician and you're saying your taxpayers are subsidising somebody else to that extent in two relatively small councils. Have you the opportunity to look at that, the CPP failure, the CHP failure in Glasgow, the regional plan that Sir John Arbuthnot was engaged in trying to get all the councils in the Clyde Valley to coordinate and share, which doesn't seem to have progressed at all? There have been some quite significant major projects of the sort of radical sort that you seem to be saying we need to look at, but they are, you know, for the large part, any of the radical things seem to have failed. So I'm just a little surprised I didn't see this in your report.
I think there's a slightly different agenda, touches on community planning, but it's more, I think what you're talking about is more the relationship between council to council rather than community planning partnerships. But let me try and address the point you're making, particularly that, first of all, the Stirling Clough Manning one. I think if there's a criticism I would make of that, the input is a judgment about money, a saving. The judgment should be, does that shared service deliver better outcomes in terms of education? And I don't know what evidence the two councils have. Did it actually, for a small council like Manning, been involved in a partnership which might have access to a wider set of resources? You with me? Would that deliver better outcomes for children? Because presumably that was the point in doing it at the beginning. I think it does underline the point that in shared services, the partners need to be very clear what are the outcomes that they're trying to achieve. Mm. On the second point, in terms of, you're right to refer to Sir John Arbuthnot's report, I think what one of the difficulties that happened there is that there was, whilst there was an initial enthusiasm for it, in many cases it came down to a question of, well, I'm not prepared to give up my jobs in Hamilton to go to Glasgow. And there was a kind of defensiveness in relation to that. The Commission has no view as to whether shared services are a good or a bad thing. The important thing is to have a very, very clear business case that sets out the outcomes and the benefits of it. There are, however, significant steps for councils to take well before shared services. The danger in shared services has been kind of the panacea, the answer to everything. There's still a huge amount of scope in the Commission's views for councils to look at their processes and procedures. The process, for example, of paying a bill, an invoice by a council, to look at how that council, a council, compares with the best in class. And if, for example, Clackmannan Council, it costs them £5 to pay a council tax, another council can do it for £2. What we would want them to do is to drill down and find out why that council can do it for £2 as opposed to their £5. So a message in there about councils simplifying their procedures, standardising their procedures, and only if there's a business case to share services should they do that. I think there's a huge amount of scope for councils to look at their individual costs in comparison with other councils and become more efficient.
I mean, I think that's the thing I was, when I was on the Health Committee, I banged on about endlessly over most of the 13 years is the variation, and yep. We could narrow the variation to the point you made earlier. But is there the data set? I mean, in the integrated joint boards, we now have the IRF, the Integrated Resource Framework, and we have the new framework on top of that of additional information, which is going to be looked at later today. Do we have that similarly for the CPPs so that they can look at things of the sort you've talked about, the variation in costs, and saying, how do we actually deal with the best practice? And that fits into the second part, my second main question, which is, in the health side, we've got Health Improvement Scotland. I'm not saying that they are perfect, but at least they do try on a non-mandatory basis to try and get good practice identified and spread. But in backing up the IJBs in their extended role, you know, are we going to just simply have the HIS doing a little bit of it again? Or, you know, is the structure nationally in terms of pushing the IJBs alongside the CPPs, you know, because that landscape is now going to be cluttered, picking up best practice and spreading it? Who's going to be responsible in government for that? Is there going to be an identifiable, clear source I can go to on a website and say, that council's doing that, why are we not doing it? So if I'm a councillor, I can pick it up and question my officials on it.
Let me just pick up the point on data information, firstly by councils. There's the national benchmarking information, and we encourage councils to drill down and look at their performance and see if they can improve in relation to the particular family of councils they're in. And I know work has been undertaken to develop indicators for community planning partnerships. I think the point I would make about IGBs is exactly the same point as we've made about community planning partnerships, the importance of a coordinated programme by local government and national government to ensure that improvement activity is well coordinated. That's been the lesson of CPPs, and I think it's very clear that many of the issues and lessons that have applied to CPPs will be exactly the same for IGBs.
I think that's exactly right. We say around paragraph 74 of this report that although there are lots of bits of improvement support available, it's still not coordinated to really get that critical mass and capacity in place and then be able to tailor it to what individual partnerships need. I'd agree entirely with Douglas that many of the issues are likely to be similar with the IJBs and the criminal justice field when that bill comes into legislation as well. And we need to make sure that that improvement support and all of the things that go around it, like what works Scotland, really are being used once to best effect rather than being replicated on a smaller scale and potentially diluting the effect that they have.
And the last question is on Exhibit 2, which is the one about indicators versus outcomes versus, I can't read it now because my glasses are too, the print's too small, but the last one anyway. I think it's short, medium or long term, but yeah. How does that compare with your previous examination? I mean, if we're all agreed that actually we've been far too focused on processes and that targets, whilst very valuable, I mean, it's particularly in health, they've been hugely important in driving the system forward to a point I wouldn't recognise as a doctor in 1997 where we are now. It's just a fantastic change. But, you know, they are now getting in the way because they're not nuanced. So, you know, how much of a switch from indicators to outcomes to medium long term instead of short term are you perceiving, or is it relatively stuck?
Probably the most important statement about that issue that we make in the report is at the end of paragraph 56, where we say that the review group that was looking at this concluded that the need for change was well understood and accepted, but there wasn't an agreement about what change was needed and how to achieve it. So I think there's been progress insofar as there is now a recognition of the problem and that something must be done. What we haven't got is much evidence so far of streamlining all of the indicators and targets and frameworks that you pointed to in Exhibit 2 of this report. Still some very large numbers of indicators, particularly around, and still focusing much more towards inputs rather than to outcomes. That's not to say it's easy. I don't want to give the impression that it could be fixed overnight, but I think you're right. It is very important in making a reality of this.
Yes. Okay. So that's something that our legacy report maybe needs to reflect, that things need to be outcome-driven rather than process-driven to a greater extent than it is. I mean, we'll never get rid of targets. I mean, targets are politicians' delight, opposition and government, but if they're not nuanced, they are actually, in my view, dangerous. I mean, the 12-week legal guarantee, 100%, for example, is I've attacked that on many occasions. You can't have a 100% guarantee, and the legal guarantee that's been broken for 32,000 Scots since it came in is a disrespectful to the law, frankly. I'm not asking you to comment on that, but I think, you know, I really worry about a legal guarantee of that sort affecting clinical priorities within the health system, and it's one of the worst examples of targets actually being counterproductive in terms of both costs, but more importantly, patient outcomes. So.
Okay.
Yes.
Nigel Dunn.
Thank you, Convener. Good morning, colleagues. I'd like to carry on where Dr. Richard Simpson has been going, actually. If I could start with the well-understood phenomenon of leaders working in silos, and that's because of their perceived responsibilities to those who employ them or govern them. Now, I'm left with the impression that those who are in public service, and let me say the police and the court service, just to get two together, could easily work together because they're responsible to the government.
I get the impression, however, that those who are elected, and clearly in this context that's local councillors, always feel that they're looking over their shoulders, always have a very territorial responsibility, and as I was one once upon a time, I recognise that. And I'm just wondering whether there is any way round that, that you have seen, either in good practice or elsewhere, that will enable, as I perceive it, particularly elected members to get outside their territorial responsibilities and actually do the collective thing over a wider area? Or are we just stuck with that?
Could you maybe expand a little bit on that?
I'm left with the perception, and I don't want to personalise this at any stage at all, that the leader of a local authority council is going to find it very difficult to sit on a joint board with other local councils and a health board, which will have a wider area, and actually really commit his council's resources to the wider area. I think it comes back to this point about authorities working together. It's just an instinct that, you know, I'm the guardian of those for my people, because they are my people, they elected me, whereas constituency MSPs will recognise this phenomenon too, completely. And I think it's actually very difficult for councillors to sanction anything that looks like we're giving some resources to somebody else.
Well, I mean, I would like to think that the motivation for the council leader is not territorial, but what's in the best interests of his or her constituents. I mean, there are examples of that. City Deal, for example, mm-hmm. where councils have come together and in a sense, seen the potential of councils working together to improve the economy in the areas. Aberdeenshire most recently have come together on a city deal. In Glasgow, the Clyde Valley. So I think there's a willingness to look more widely than simply the territory of an individual council, and to think of the potential of generating wealth in that area, which can benefit all constituents, including the leader's own constituent.
Could I perhaps just challenge that, though, in the sense that that's about other money coming in. That's additional money, and I think councillors, under that circumstance, again, I don't want to personalise it to Aberdeenshire, but if Aberdeen City sees that they're getting 30% and Aberdeenshire is getting 70%, and I'm making up the numbers, if it's new money, well, I'm getting 30% of the new money and actually we'll benefit from the rest of it, that's okay. It's very easy to be generous at that stage. When you're actually looking at your core budget, and it's a shrinking budget, to actually say, well, I will do anything at all that might actually mean some of that budget goes somewhere else, seems to me to be quite difficult. And I think that's actually,
I think we
see examples.
I think it's less about money going somewhere else as opposed to saying, can we get better outcomes collectively by sharing our budget, by putting our budget together? If, for example, there are scarce resources, it may be in the interest of a council, for example, to share specialised resources like, say, procurement, educational psychologists. You get a better service for the public by sharing resources. I think many council leaders would look to saying the motivation would be, how can we get a better outcomes for our citizen? And there are opportunities for councils to share where there is a business case so to do.
You'd be able to point to examples where that's been done on a substantial scale.
I mean, I think in Aberdeenshire, for example, sharing on procurement, they're doing more work on sharing finance functions, internal audit, for example, where the resources have declined. There are quite a lot of examples across Scotland where the councils are doing that because they see the benefit in so doing. I think the key issue, always for leaders and for councils, is that the public want to know there's a clear line of accountability. Who's accountable if you have a service like that? Where is the accountability line? That's an important factor as well. I think it will be interesting as resources continue to be constrained, whether there is more an appetite within local government to look to working more in partnerships where that adds demonstrable value and where there's a business case to support it.
Okay. I wonder if I could move on, Convener. I won't be the first official report that's got, quote, what gets measured gets done. but I'm going to do it again, and I've just done it. And Exhibit 2, to which Dr. Richard Simpson just previously referred, I think is a hugely useful infographic, and I really am in favour of these things. Thank you for it. Clearly, the vast majority of the measures are the input-output performance short-term. That's very clearly what it's intended to demonstrate. Can I put it to you, Auditor General, that that's may not necessarily be a bad thing, because it might well be that if there are 20 things that can go wrong, you need to have 20 numbers to know whether they're going wrong, whereas actually if life's okay, you might need one or two measures to demonstrate that it's okay. So can I just ask, whilst I understand what you're trying to demonstrate there, what does need to change in order to get people to focus on the outcomes? Do they just need more outcome measures?
I think the first thing to say is you're absolutely right. We're not saying you can just measure outcomes and everything else goes by the board, not least because most outcomes will take a generation to fix, and keeping our fingers crossed for 20 years probably isn't a very sensible strategy. What we are keen to make sure is that the measures that underpin the outcomes are the ones that will genuinely take you in the direction you want for changing and improving your outcomes over time. And we've talked previously about some of the unintended consequences of input or activity measures on the outcomes that you're looking for. There's also something quite subtle, I think, about taking a measure and turning it into a target. As Dr. Simpson said, it can have a very powerful effect on a priority or a bottleneck or something you're trying to fix. Equally, I think it can also have an unintended effect. And one of the examples we've reported on before is that the four-hour A&E target is an important target that matters to people and has seen a huge improvement over the last over the life of this Parliament, no question about it. Those figures are now reported weekly and receive a lot of attention, a lot of public focus, a lot of media focus. I challenge, I think, most people in this room to give any indication of what the equivalent might be for people waiting for a care package in the community is. And that's just as important in some ways. The fact of the focus on A&E drives people's attention and efforts and resources towards that in a way that not only neglects the rest of the system, but potentially distorts away from it. That's the easiest example to point to. But I think the conclusions of the work that's been done by the board set up by the Scottish Government and COSLA to do this are that there are other examples of that sort of approach where taking one part of the system either potentially ignores important things or even drives the wrong outcomes elsewhere. So it's really that streamlining with appropriate mapping of different measures at different levels and short, medium and long term as well.
You said earlier that's the whole system approach which is required, and of course I think we endorse that and understand it. Could I just lastly turn though to the issue of IJBs, Integration Joint Boards, and Community Planning Partnerships. IJBs now have a timetable, which is actually pretty close. Given, as Mr. Sinclair has previously commented, that in many places it will be the same people trying to worry about both partnerships. If IJBs have a timetable and CPPs have managed to wait this long, is there any real prospect that they will be the focus of people's attentions?
Well, yes, because they're statutory bodies. That's the difference. And they have an accountability to ministers to report annually on the outcomes specified by government and the progress they're making in relation to that. It's a different beast altogether. So that I think will drive it much more effectively. Could I just return to the point you made about sharing, because it did make me reflect on the fact that, or a sense that councils are not that good at sharing. I can think in my time in my career of at least a couple of examples where the Director of Finance and a Health Board retired, and the council offered to take over that responsibility and provide a shared service for the health board and for the council, and in both cases that was turned down by the health department. Sorry.
So you said your town? So you just clarify which.
That was Orkney, and yeah.
So just Scottish to clarify for the record.
Scottish Borders.
Yeah.
So you know the bit about sharing is I think is wider than just a criticism of councils. There's a general attitude that sometimes an attitude in central government there's an unwillingness to share what might seem something that would give benefit and save money.
Well,
Can I second Livia here? Again, I don't want to get too territorial or too personal, but I mean, Council's not a very million miles away from where I have been over my career. Have totally failed to say to join up even the backroom services, the accounting bits. You know, if they can't manage to do that, essentially for territorial it's mine reasons, as I perceive it, then I don't think there's much prospect that they're ever going to join up the sharp end.
Well,
forgive my cynicism.
Conkia.
Thanks, Convener. Good morning. Actually, quite a lot of what I've got noted here has come in, particularly in the first part of Nigel Don's questioning. And it really is, from my background, coming from local authority into Parliament, virtually everything that Nigel Don and, to an extent, Richard Simpson, Colin Beattie have already said is perfectly true. And shared services are absolutely, there's nothing new in the idea of shared services. I remember having discussions some years ago on this. So it takes us really down to the fact we know it's incremental, and why is it incremental? Why is it not? Why are the changes happening that way? Might I suggest that, you know, there are obvious sort of things in the political climates that we all live in. There's strains between the Scottish Government and COSLA. There's strains between COSLA and local government. And, of course, you try and take the power from any partner into a sort of general pot, you will automatically get to the point where somebody will fight for that. It cannot be easy. And understand these are all the problems, and I think some of the questioning has been there. So it takes us down to the fact, if we really want to speed things up, how do we get these four elements all together? Scottish Government, COSLA, local authorities, I know they're the same thing, but there is a clear difference between them, there's clear arguments. And also this idea of partnership, because if you are a councillor going to your Monday night surgery and you get somebody coming up to the door and saying, can you help me with this, councillor? And he's sitting there going, or she is sitting there and going, well, I can, but it's not really the council's business, but it's the council that's providing it, perhaps, on behalf of a partner. And this accountability that we seem to be sort of waving over a little bit, how do we actually get the public to understand that there is, if not statutory, but pretty close to it, shared services in here? How do we get it moving? And how do we get the public to understand that? Because if you go outside, the chances are a member of the public will not understand what a community planning partnership is.
I think that's absolutely right, and I'm sure Douglas will want to come in. I'll kick off by saying I think the way we convince the public that shared services are a thing and are important is by delivering good shared services, so you don't end up with people sort of passing responsibility or concerns backwards and forwards. I recognise all of the things in the environment at the moment that you highlight as making this more difficult than it otherwise would be. All of that is true, and it's still the case that community planning is a central part of the government's reform agenda. If government and COSLA were to conclude that actually in that context doing this is over-ambitious, is not possible, then I think what we'd be looking to see is a plan B that says in that case how are we going to manage the continuing constrained money for the next few years and the policy commitment to move towards prevention. At the moment, community planning and the things related to it are the main thrust to achieving that. If that's not the case, then what's the alternative to doing that? You're right, though, it's a very difficult set of challenges, both for individual councillors and for the public bodies involved to tackle.
I think I'd just add to that. I think the case for community planning still exists. If you say the police are responsible for crime, the causes of crime are out with the control of the police. This could be bad housing, lack of employment opportunities, poor education, what have you. So the need for bodies to come together and design services around the individual and around communities in a joined up way is critically important. And the public expects services to be joined up. That was the whole point of the Christie Commission, and indeed it's the driver in the integrated joint boards as well. I think we come back to the point in our report that if this is a flagship policy for the government, then the importance of national leadership at both the level of the Scottish Government and COSLA in terms of a coordinated support framework, in terms of an effective performance management framework. These are they're the bodies that can will the means to make this more effective.
Thank you, Convener. Earlier on in your contribution, Mr. Sinclair, you mentioned, well, you posed a question, that was certainly my interpretation of what you said, just regarding the need for both the HSCPs and also the CPPs. Am I correct in picking that up from you?
What I was suggesting, and I think that answered the question, if you put community planning partnerships on a statutory basis, is there space within Scotland in a very complex public sector landscape to have two statutory bodies, two statutory partnerships? I think you know, where does one stop and the other one start might be an issue. I think that's something we need to think about very carefully.
Okay. So, because later on you highlighted the point regarding the capacity to support the CPPs. And also, maybe it may well be that some of the same individuals are attempting to do both.
Yeah, okay. I think we are finding in our audit work, particularly in small councils, as councils reduce their workforce and through voluntary redundancy, one of the dangers is that in specialised areas that small councils begin to lose really important staff to do pretty important jobs.
In the report, on page 26, Exhibit 2, regarding the statutory versus non-statutory. Now, it may well be a policy question, so you probably won't want to answer. But in terms of the 20% versus 80% ratio, do you think, well, is your opinion that those percentages need to be altered in some shape or form, so that the statutory element actually is an increase on the 20% to try to provide I think the phrase that I hear on a regular basis in the chamber is for a consistent approach in terms of service delivery across the country, but the difficulty that I always have with that is that then looked upon that central government dictating to local authorities what they should and should not do? Because ultimately, it's people at local authority level and organisations who are delivering services within local authorities, within the local authority areas, they're the ones who best know that particular area as compared to whichever party is in power at central government level.
I think my concern is less about whether the measures are statutory or non-statutory than about whether they are pointing you towards the longer-term outcomes that you're looking to improve. We touched on that discussion earlier. There may be some measures that government thinks are so important it wants to set into statute. Obviously, the argument against that is that things change over time and that what's very important this year may look quite different in 5 years' time. But it's less my... what I think is interesting about this exhibit is less any one of the individual things you could pull out from it, but whether it looks like a coherent picture overall for achieving the national outcomes with every public body and communities across Scotland playing their part in doing it. The statutory, non-statutory dimension is one, but it's not the most important from my perspective.
I think just to add to that, one of the confusions around the statement of ambition was whether it was simply community planning partnerships delivering on national outcomes, and whether there was a sufficient space within community planning partnerships to deliver on local priorities as well. And getting that balance right seems to me to be quite important.
I just going to mention that one of the issues that the senior officer group identified when looking at this exhibit themselves was in the 20%, 80%, statutory, non-statutory, the fact that 80% of the measures are non-statutory arguably identify scope for a bit of decluttering of the landscape because they're not underpinned by primary legislation.
That's a very good point. Because I think the example I was going to come on to, which was touched upon earlier, was the benchmarking tool, was in terms of local authorities. Now, that's not a statutory tool. And it's also a tool with a level of flexibility that, that indicators can change on an annual basis. Also based upon exactly what you said there, Caroline, in terms of the landscape can change within a short space of time. So I think certainly in terms of the in terms of that particular tool, could that be looked at in terms of a measurement tool for not solely for local authorities, but is that something that could be looked upon maybe as an additional type of tool for community planning partnerships or for other kind of joint operations to allow that flexibility without having the need to have a statutory element?
That action's already taking place. So the Improvement Service has been working with a number of CPPs to develop a benchmarking data set that they can use for identifying how well they're moving and how quickly they're moving towards delivering the outcomes that they're all committed to. There's also quite a lot of interesting work going on within government to try and make sure that the data that CPPs might need to plan and understand local needs and also set targets for improvement is available at very local level, so they can really focus on the needs of specific communities. So that's an agenda that people are moving forward on.
Okay.
It's not quite right to say the National Performance Framework is not a statutory tool. That derives from the fact that the statutory responsibility for specifying performance information lies with the Commission. The Commission a few years ago decided that it wanted local government to take much more ownership of performance and performance information, and that's why we've allowed the development through SOLAS and COSLA of the National Performance Information. But we are very clear in our direction that we expect councils to use that to drill down and to look at their performance in comparison with other councils. That's the acid test, to learn from the information that's made available.
Well, exactly. I mean, I used to be a member of the Local Government Regeneration Committee, and I was there at the time when the benchmarking tool came into being, and certainly that was the ethos. Yeah. I'm very much supportive of that whole. Of the whole idea, because I mean it's exactly right. I mean there will be very good examples of work that are taking place, and I'm sure everyone will want it to be a success.
Okay, I've got a brief additional question from Mary Scanlon.
Yes, we've looked at the report today and scrutinised that, but I really just wanted to look at your final words in paragraph 82. Which, to be honest, are neither hopeful or optimistic for the future. And if I may read, what is clear is that continuing on the current path of delivering local improvements is unlikely to deliver the system-wide transformational change outlined in the statement of ambition. Now, given the historic events that I've outlined today, I appreciate you would never write anything that was less than honest, but it doesn't actually fill me with confidence that the questions that have been raised by colleagues today, the issues that have been raised, and the contents of all your reports, it doesn't give me much confidence that things are going to change in future and we are going to deliver the outcomes that we hoped. Am I misinterpreting this, or is that it's your final point?
Thank you. I think you're not misinterpreting it. I think the strong message that's been coming through our evidence this morning is that community planning is, as Douglas has said, a flagship policy of the government, a key part of the response to the Christie Commission and the challenges of tight financial resources and moving towards prevention. And the progress that we're seeing so far is real, but it is small scale and incremental, and it's not leading to the sort of transformational change that was envisaged when the statement of ambition was agreed between the government and COSLA. If it's going to continue holding that place in policy terms, then much more strong national leadership is needed, as we say in the report.
I've no doubt future audit committees will come back to it.
Any other questions from colleagues? Okay, can I thank the Auditor General for what will be our final report before this parliamentary session? Can I take this opportunity to thank the Auditor General and our staff for the support you've given to the committee over this parliamentary session, and we wish you the very best for the future.
Thank you very much, Convener. It's a pleasure and a privilege for us all to support this committee. We're pleased to have been able to do it through this session of Parliament, and we're very much looking forward to working with the new Parliament in future. And best wishes to everybody. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you. Okay, colleagues, can we move to agenda item number 3, which is the response from the Scottish Government to the committee's request for further specific information relating to the Auditor General's report entitled NHS in Scotland 2015. Can I ask colleagues for comments or actions? Richard Simpson?
Yes. The, it's very interesting, this backlog maintenance issue, that the, you know, that their target is now a 2020 target. The previous target was a 2015 target, which they didn't meet. And I certainly wasn't aware, for one, that there was a new target of 2020 of £100 per square metre of the estate, and 10% of that only to be high risk. This is a completely different set of targets to the one previously, which was a new, which was a target defined in number of millions of pounds. So I'm slightly concerned that we've got these new targets. But even if you take what they say in the letter, the figures are £181 per square metre, and 47% are high risk. That is a huge amount. And actually, it seems to me, Chair, that what might be useful for us to go back and say is not, I think we will not get much further in terms of further information, I think, but I think it is pretty, I mean, this is pretty obfuscating. I mean, the transparency is really rather lacking. But what I think is important is, in that high-risk element, how much is actually clinically important and how much is not clinically important? So if I can give you an example of clinically important, the sewage running down the walls of the Southern General in the last couple of weeks, which is a problem that has occurred on a number of occasions over the last few years, seems to me to be such high risk that, you know, that it should have been dealt with. And I just think that the system, the next committee is going to have to ask Audit Scotland to look into this in far greater depth and actually produce stuff that is meaningful and helpful. And I don't know, I really don't know if it's worthwhile going back and asking further for intermediate targets, at least. If the target of 2020 is 100, what are they going to do about the high-risk stuff? Because my other concern, and just finish on this, my other concern is, what's high-risk, what's low-risk today, if it's clinically important, might become high risk tomorrow. It's not a statutory, it gives the impression that there's a sort of fixed feast in this. There isn't. You know, things are going to come onto the agenda as being risk, and they're going to be things that are come onto the agenda from low risk to high risk. And it's actually seeing that process. I just feel the whole thing is just very, very, very obscure. And I'm really concerned that the government has set targets for 2015-16. They have missed those targets and missed them by quite a long way because the boards have not delivered on the existing high risk, as far as I can see. So the only question I would think we might go back and ask is, how much of the high risk that was defined in 2012, 13, 14, 15 has actually gone off the agenda? How much of that has been met in each of those years? Because if the high risk from 2012 hasn't been met now, what's the point of defining it as high risk?
BT?
Yep, I don't disagree with what Richard Simpson says. One thing I'm curious about is, in past information we've received from the government, there's been an indication that a proportion of this backlog would be dealt with by way of, for example, new builds and so on, as opposed to maintenance in the building. And they did at one point give a percentage on that, and I'm surprised it didn't come forward again, because that would be interesting, because £181 per square metre, it could be that if we understood what was going to be replaced, that could come down substantially and maybe answer some of the questions that Richard Simpson's got. But I think it's probably a question to ask, but it is probably for the next committee now.
I'm sorry, Mary Scanlon.
I appreciate it's for the next committee convener, but for those of us that have been on this committee for most of the session, it has been an ongoing issue. And can I just say, convener, that we it's not the first time that we've seen the government, if they can't change the target, they change the date. But quite a significant change of date, which is very disappointing. But can I just also, convener, say to Richard Simpson that we did ask for a definition of high risk. And high risk is actually fairly, I don't want to use my words, but fairly detrimental, quite dangerous in terms of the health and safety to both staff and to patients. So it is an issue that we have been looking at over the 5 years, and I agree with Richard Simpson that it's something for our legacy paper for the next committee. It is a very, very serious issue, and I think on Colin Beattie's point, we've been given more explicit information in the past, which has helped us to understand if an old hospital isn't meeting the standards and a new one's being built, we can help understand moving on. We've been given less information and a shifting away out in the horizon of a target that couldn't be met.
Nigel Don?
Yeah, I just want to extend the discussion, if I may, and make the point that this is not a continuum. This is actually discrete buildings, some of which are quite big, some of which probably will be underused. And we would all recognise that if a building's old and the roof needs to be replaced, then the whole building would be regarded as being at the worst end. It might be that actually it's not even being used, or the ground floor alone is being used, and it may well be that it's going to be replaced in a year and a half's time. And therefore, no sensible person would actually be expecting you to do anything with it other than get the next one built. So we need to be able to extract, or our successors, or perhaps the Health Committee, because I'm not sure it's necessarily us, needs to be able to extract the big numbers, down from the big numbers to the individual segments of that to understand what's going on. I suspect, suggest that average numbers really actually just don't help us.
Chairman Mullen?
I agree with the comments of my colleagues, but I think it certainly would be useful for the next committee in the next session to still kind of get that information in terms of the breakdown of what is planned. Because it's something that this committee has, as Mary Scallon mentioned, it's something this committee has discussed before. So I think it's very relevant to go to a future health committee, but also for this committee to obtain that information too.
Richard Simpson?
Yeah, one final comment on this from me is that, of course, there is much criticism of what was originally PPP, then PFI, and now NPD. They're all the same, they're all privately funded, but they do include a maintenance contract. And so I think it should be recognised, and our successor committee should recognise, that these are maintained buildings. The contract requires the contractor to maintain them for the 30-year lifespan, and that is a fantastic saving to the health service in terms of going forward. And I think I would suggest, if colleagues are agreeable, that they, again in the legacy paper, that the future audit committee or health committee should be invited to look at the savings that are accruing in this area, because we've been up to £1 million of backlog of and 2.5-3 million of 250 or 300 million of high risk. Now you don't have any in the maintenance of NPD.
Colleagues, can we just pull together? So obviously, just to clarify, we do have the option to respond to the correspondence and ask for the response within the 2-week period before Parliament dissolves. So we can ask for further information. The second option is that we've not on record what's been said today and pass that to the successor audit committee. Or we can do both. See what information can be brought forward within the 2 weeks, and then whatever else is to be sought, we can suggest that to a future committee.
I think both.
And I think Chair, if we ask the high risk that was in 12, 13, 14 and 15, that was not going to be about replacement of buildings, because I think Nigel's point's absolutely right about the discreteness of the continuum, that if we ask about the things that were, take out the ones that are scheduled to be replaced, which are not being used, in other words, it's a sort of general safety issue, and say, could they provide us with a list of the high-risk things that have or have not been met that were clinically being used and are important?
The legacy document, so we just need to be.
No, that was not for the legacy document. That was for.
So, but can I suggest that we return back to correspond with Mr. Gray?
Yes.
Some of the points have been made today, and request a response within the 2-week framework. Yeah.
Okay.
Sorry. I think there's a general point here, and we're going to come to it again. I think we need to be careful to make sure that we're asking for things of significance. So there always need to be some kind of de minimis. I don't know how you set that. I'm sure that in correspondence it can be organised, but we don't want this to come down to the smallest building, 10 square metres in the corner, which isn't relevant. This needs to be relevant stuff. And we're asking people to do unnecessary
I think
work.
We can ask for common sense to prevail, but,
yes, please.
But an interest openness for... Yeah, absolutely. Absolutely. Okay. Can we move to agenda item number four, which is a response from the Scottish Government to 4 points arising from the committee's consideration of the AGS report entitled Health and Social Care Integration. And have comments from colleagues?
I think the offer that's made is one that we would, had we been carrying on, probably taken up. But I think that clearly at this point there's no time for that. Is this something we can carry forward to for the next committee? I mean, we can't put it in a legacy document now, but...
We can ask for it to be on the record.
I think that would be useful.
Okay. Is that agreed, colleagues? Yes, agreed. Okay, can we now move to agenda item number five, which is a response from the Scottish Government regarding the AGS report entitled Implementing the Scotland Act 2012, an update. The committee have asked the Scottish Government whether it accepted the report's findings and recommendations. Is the committee content to note the responses received? Is that agreed, colleagues? Okay, so can I move to agenda item number six, which is the committee's annual report. And in line with previous years, this is simply a factual report on the work of the committee for the last year. Are members content to agree the draft report and for us to liaise with the clerks to bring forward a publication date?
I don't know if it's relevant to highlight this or not, but when I read this, when we got to the final paragraph of 25, the committee met 21 times in this parliamentary year. And also all of these meetings took place here in Parliament. It struck me that the other committees have undertaken various meetings outside of the Parliament across the country, and this committee hasn't done so. Now, I know we already have.
Did a tour in NHS Island.
Oh, sorry, so okay. No.
Yeah. You were there.
No, I wasn't at that one.
Sorry.
I stand corrected. But I think certainly in terms of the external activities of other committees, clearly they have been out of the Parliament a lot more. And just to get it on record in terms of the next committee of this Parliament.
Okay, I think that's a fair point. It's been raised and obviously the work of the Audit Committee is something of the public interest, so it's something hopefully the future committee can keep in mind. So can I just point out to colleagues that this will be our final meeting before dissolution, and can I just mention that before we move into private session. I wanted to put on record our thanks to the committee, to Audit Scotland and to the Auditor General for their hard work and professionalism over the past 5 years. The reports and evidence that they've supported and provided to us has been, and I'm sure all members will agree, has been invaluable. And I'm sure our successors will be as grateful as we are for their good work during that period. I'd also like to thank our clerking team, led by Anne Pete. I think it goes without saying that without the team, we'd be lost and wouldn't be able to bring forward the committee's agenda and the various other supporting elements. I'd also like to thank the other staff who have supported us, the media team, the official reporters and sound engineers who ensure the good work of the committee is able to take forward. I'd also like to put on record my thanks to our deputy convener, Mary Scanlon, to Dr. Simpson and to Colin Keir, who I understand I'll not be seeking a re-election to the Scottish Parliament. I think we hope that you'll have a long, healthy retirement and wish you the very best for the future. Can I say my experience in the committee has been that we've worked together as a committee, despite our political differences. There's never been any divisions, despite the fact that there's a government majority built into the committee, and I think that's a credit to all members of the committee who have worked together, and I think that's the way in which the parliamentary committees should operate, is ensuring that we can work together in the common agenda. Okay, just any brief comments before we close?
Yeah, I wonder if I could make a brief comment. Can I just say to you, convener, when I came here in 1999, David McClatchy was my leader, and he said, what committee, well, he offered me health, and I said, I don't know much about it. I go to the doctor once a year, that's about it. He said, well, what is it that you want to do? And I said, I'd like to go on the audit committee. And he said, oh, that's a tick box exercise. Nobody pays any attention to that. You know, it's just a by the way committee. You know, you'd be wasting your time on that committee. And really, it's a committee that we haven't heard of much, I have to say, convener, until this last session of Parliament. And I would like to thank Hugh Henry. I think he gave me the courage to be a bit more feisty in committee. I'd like to thank Ian Gray. But most of all, convener, I think this is the first committee that you have convened. I would like to thank you, because I think you have chaired this committee in a thoroughly professional manner. You have taken each and every one of us with you, both in public and private sessions. And I think, and it's only my humble opinion, which isn't worth much, but I used to watch Margaret Hodge at Westminster and think, that's a really good public accounts committee. Maybe we should be a bit more like that. And I think, convener, that each and every one of us round the table, under your leadership and with the help of John Doyle and a few other characters along the way, I think with the forensic questioning of Tavish Scott, the longer standing committee members, and our resident auditor here, Colin Beattie, myself and yourself, I think we've brought this committee on a level pretty close to the Public Accounts Committee at Westminster. And I know that out there, people looked at John Doyle and thought, I don't want to be there. And I think they might be paying a little bit more attention to the handouts that they take, and they might even check their contracts for IT systems in future before signing them. But convener, I think you're measured, thoughtful, you're consensual, and thoroughly professional approach. I would like to commend you on that. It has been a privilege working with you, and it's been a great privilege working on this committee. And again, I'd like to thank the Auditor General and her staff. Thank you so much.
Convener, I'd just like to join in your sentiments, thanking the Auditor General and her team, the clerks, everyone else involved, the members around the table, and yourself as convener and Mary as vice convener. I think that this committee has generally operated in the best example of a parliamentary committee. I think we've been quite collegiate as a group, cross-party, and I welcome that. And you know, I personally have enjoyed my 5 years here, and we'll see what the dice roll next year to see where we all end up next time.
Okay. Richard Simpson.
The late comer to this committee, can I say that I've thoroughly enjoyed my brief time on it. But over the 13 years that I've been in the Parliament, the Audit Scotland role has been phenomenally important in every committee that I've sat on, which is mainly health, although I was on finance at the beginning as well. But, you know, their role is without their reports, I think that we would not be providing the sort of scrutiny that we've been able to provide. And it's been a great pleasure these last few months to serve on this on this committee, and feel that this has been the most collegiate committee that I've served on since the first Parliament, in fact. So in that respect, I commend colleagues for that.
Thank you.
First of all, can I thank you for your comments? I totally agree with the comments in relation to the Auditor General and the staff, the support, and of course to my fellow members. Of course, a couple of us are not coming back, so we have the privilege of looking back, and perhaps like most other people originally seen audit as a bit of a dry subject to be in, but what we've actually come across is some of the most important situations, events, calling people to account that this Parliament has. It's not like any other committee, and I welcome the consensus, and it's been an honour and privilege to serve in it. So thank you very much, and the best of luck for the future.
Shipman Nolan.
Thank you, convener. I agree with the comments that we've made so far. The thing that really kind of has struck me about this committee in this session has really been about the collegiate fashion that members have undertaken their duties. And it's, I've been fortunate to be on committees where that has happened on a regular basis, but not in its entirety. But I think certainly with this committee and the members on it, we have tried to work together as a team, and I think everyone deserves some credit for that. And it shows that when the politicians from the various parties can actually come together, then we can actually get a good job done, and we certainly have done that. And my final point is that a former member of this Parliament and committee was Andrew Welsh. And Andrew, I was in the last session when I joined the Audit Committee at the very beginning of the session in 2007. Andrew said to me that that the Audit Committee, it's a fabulous committee to be on. Audit Scotland, they provide you with the bullets and it's up to you to fire the gun. And he said that to me on a regular basis. And but certainly Audit Scotland certainly do provide valuable information and a huge amount of assistance. And I think certainly the members of this committee in this session have certainly undertaken their duties with that information to hand. So certainly thank you very much to Audit Scotland and that wee anecdote about Andrew Welsh. It's something that will always stick with me in this place.
Okay, colleagues, before there's any disagreement, just finally, we've got apologies from Tavi Scott and can I now move the committee into private session.